going to finish today. So that homework is due by midnight tonight. I'm not going to push it back like I sometimes do when we're late finishing, because I want you to get it done so you can be studying for the exam next week. All right, so the homework will be due tonight by midnight. On Friday, we'll review, and then on there'll be no class on Monday, and then exam one is on Wednesday, and we're in Walsh 215. So that's one of the smaller computer labs, because we are a smaller class. So we will do that next Wednesday. All right. So last time we started the process of putting together some of these different terms and variables in how the body regulates blood pressure and blood flow, right? So one of the things we talked about extensively was cardiac output and how that is the amount of blood that leaves the heart per minute. And we can calculate cardiac output, or we can think about cardiac output, as stroke volume times heart rate. In other words, how much blood does the heart pump out, stroke volume in each beat, and then how many times does it beat per minute? All right? So this term is part of a larger relationship that has to do with blood pressure, and that's what we're going to get to today. So ultimately, we're going to see that blood pressure is cardiac output times what we call total peripheral resistance, right? But what this slide is all about, and this comes right from your book, is just this cardiac output piece, which when you take a look at this, all this complexity, that's the worst part, right? That's the part where there's the most variability, and it's because there are a ton of factors that can affect cardiac output. And this slide sort of goes through some of those. So for example, heart rate and stroke volume, right? The components of cardiac output. What affects heart rate? Well, the principal one is sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. So the autonomics. The sympathetic nervous system, the fight or flight system, it increases heart rate. The parasympathetic nervous system decreases it. Now, there are a couple of other things that can affect heart rate, too. Other hormones. So thyroid hormone, for example, increases heart rate. So just like epinephrine does in the fight or flight response. Oh, I lost my mouse. There it is. Another is body temperature. The lower the body temperature, the slower the heart rate. And this is it's an intrinsic property of the heart itself. So as the core body temperature cools, the heart beats slower because the pacemaker essentially slows down. So that the temperature piece is not controlled necessarily by the brain or by the hormones. It's actually a direct effect of temperature on the heart. So like when they do heart surgery, very often they'll chill the patient down. To, you know, 80 degrees or even 70 or even 60 degrees, because the colder the patient, the slower the heartbeat, and the cooler the patient, the less oxygen demand there is. So if you're going to stop the heart for a period of time and fix something, it's good to have the patient nice and cold so that they don't have their oxygen requirement is much, much lower. All right. So sympathetic hormones, temperature, that's heart rate. So heart rate is kind of the easy piece. Well, what about stroke volume? Well, the best way to look at the stroke volume pieces is to look at the two aspects of what makes stroke volume. So that's end diastolic volume, EDV, and end systolic volume, ESV. So end diastolic volume is how full the heart is before it starts to contract. So it's how full is it? And then ESV is how empty does the heart get at the end of a contraction? In other words, how small did it get? How much blood is left in it? So if we subtract the what's left at the end from what is present full at the beginning, the difference there is how much blood actually left the heart. And we can sort of organize our thinking about stroke volume by looking at these two variables sort of independently. All right, so EDV, what affects EDV? Well, one is what we call venous return. In other words, how much blood comes back to the heart. And that's sort of what this box is talking about. We talked about that skeletal muscle pump and how it helps to push blood back up towards the heart. There are a couple of other mechanisms that do that same thing. And when they're very active, venous return increases. So when our venous return goes up, that causes an increase in end-diastolic volume. Now, the opposite is also true. So if venous return goes down, end-diastolic volume also goes down. So if this number gets bigger, stroke volume gets bigger, cardiac output gets bigger, right? So the more blood that comes back to the heart, the higher the venous return, the greater the stroke volume, the greater the cardiac output. All right, so that's sort of this piece. It's also this piece here as well. Venous return can be altered by changes in the vascular system. So when we talked about the vessels in the last chapter, we talked about venous capacitance, you know, how the veins can shrink and increase the amount of blood that's circulating actively. That's another way venous return can go up. So think venous return and then all the ways that that can increase are sort of included then in your thinking, which is why I use that term, venous return. Another aspect that we sort of just scratched the surface of yesterday, but we're going to talk more about today, is plasma volume. So the circulatory system has a volume of blood in it, right? You know, you have about 4 to 6 liters of blood in your entire body. That's plasma volume. How much blood is in the system, the whole cardiovascular system. And normally, you know, in the normal healthy person, plasma volume doesn't change very much. You know, it might decrease a little while you sleep at night because you're not drinking, or, you know, you're not putting any fluid in. But generally speaking, plasma volume is stable. Not the case, though, in trauma. You know, if you lose blood for some reason, your plasma volume is going to decrease. Another way plasma volume decreases is dehydration. So if you're not taking in enough fluid to counter how much fluid you lose, the circulating blood volume is going to get smaller and smaller. So why does that matter? Less blood in the system, less venous return, right? So there's a relationship. As plasma volume decreases, either from hemorrhage or from dehydration, your venous return is going to decrease. So the sort of short version is, as plasma volume goes up, in other words, as the amount of blood in the system goes up, the end diastolic volume goes up. Another way to think of it is, as the plasma volume goes up, the venous return goes up. Okay? So this matters most in its opposite. When plasma volume goes down, the venous return goes down, which means the end diastolic volume goes down, and ultimately the cardiac output goes down. So in a patient who's dehydrated, their cardiac output and their blood pressure may be affected because they don't have adequate plasma volume, all right? And we're going to see how the kidney can affect this variable in a later slide once we get into blood pressure here in a minute, all right? So that's this piece right here is where they're talking about plasma volume. That's this box. So all of those things affect end-diastolic volume. And the one that they left out of their piece here in this box is this last component, filling time. So filling time is the amount of time that the heart has to fill up before it contracts. And filling time is directly related to heart rate. As heart rate goes up, heart's beating faster, the amount of time that the heart has to fill goes down, right? Because the pump is beating so fast, it doesn't have as much time to fill up. So the lower the filling time, the lower the end diastolic volume. So it's one of the reasons why we don't ever have heart rates of like 220 beats per minute, you know, like a mouse has a heart rate, can have a heart rate like that. But our hearts are too big for that. The reason is, as the heart rate gets very, very high, the filling time gets so short that the heart can't fill, so it can't really pump very well. So another thing that affects EVV is this filling time piece. As filling time goes down, end diastolic volume goes down, which makes stroke volume go down and cardiac output go down. So that one they didn't put in their end diastolic volume piece.
Is there a safety net, like if you're exercising and your heart is starting to beat fast, is there something in your body that will slow it down?
Essentially, you will slow down. What the brain will do to handle that is reduce how vigorously you're exercising to get your expenditure below what it can provide for.
That's exhaustion too. You know, like if you can't sprint forever, and one of the reasons you can't is the body will shut you down because it can't maintain that degree of oxygenation. Yeah. All right, so this whole box right here is end diastolic volume. All right, well, what about the other one? End systolic volume is how small the heart gets at the end of its contraction. And there are a number of things that affect it as well. Okay, so one common one is this word right here, contractility. Not only can the heart speed up and slow down, it can work harder or work less hard. So we call that contractility, and the sympathetic nervous system can increase the heart's contractility. So can other hormones, which is what they talk about a little over there in the corner. So like, again, thyroid hormone, for example, makes the heart beat better. So when contractility goes up, the heart is working harder. So what does that mean? It means that it gets smaller at the end of its contraction each time. You know, it's squeezing that extra little bit, and that reduces end systolic volume, which increases stroke volume and increases cardiac output. Why an increase? Because if you subtract a smaller number, you're going to have a larger term, right? So increasing those, that's contractility. And then another major player is afterload. So that's this box right here, afterload. Afterload is the pressure the heart has to push against to do its job at all. So in the aorta and in the pulmonary trunk, there is always a blood pressure. You know, that's the diastolic blood pressure, 120 over 80. So that means when the heart is relaxing, there's 80 millimeters of mercury in the aorta. Well, before the heart can start to push blood out, it has to build up that much pressure in order to open the door, so to speak. That is afterload. It's best reflected as the diastolic blood pressure. So as the afterload goes up, in other words, as the pressure the heart has to push against increases, it is less good at contracting completely. So the end systolic volume goes up. So if we subtract a higher term, we get a smaller term. So stroke volume goes down, cardiac output goes down as afterload goes up. And in this diagram, they talk about how afterload can be affected by vasodilation and vasoconstriction. So all over the body, you know, the arteries have muscle in their walls, so they can get bigger and they can get smaller. When arteries get bigger, we call that vasodilation. It increases blood flow and reduces blood pressure. Vasoconstriction is just the opposite. The vessel gets smaller, the resistance gets bigger, the pressure gets higher. So, and we're going to talk about TPR more in a minute, but these two relate to afterload. So when vasodilation goes up, afterload goes down. And when vasoconstriction goes up, afterload goes up as well. So there is a relationship there, as your book points out. So I know this diagram looks very complex, but it's actually a pretty well-organized and simple portrayal of all those complicated terms that we have over there. So, you know, that is sort of the short, almost math-like version. This one has more words in it, so depending on what kind of mind you have, this may be a better study slide for you. But there's a lot of good information on here. I encourage you to sort of go through it at your own pace. All right. So all of these things reflect how cardiac output can change according to what the body needs. All right. Okay. So in order to put the whole system in motion and understand it, we have to look at blood pressure and blood flow, right? Because blood flow is what it's all about. You know, the cardiovascular system, it functions because it's circulating all the time. And it can't circulate without some energy to make that happen. The energy that moves blood is blood pressure. So the reason why clinically we pay such attention to blood pressure is because it's the power that makes the circulation happen. And without a circulation, cells are dying because they're not getting what they need. So the major players here, we have the heart generating cardiac output. We have the arterial blood pressure that comes about from peripheral resistance, and we'll talk about each of these pieces as we go. The capillary is where the business actually occurs, and that is the exchange of nutrients and waste products into the blood and into the tissues, so where the vascular system actually does its job. The venous system has to return blood back to the heart so that the whole system can go round and round. And then the brain and the kidney have to control this mess because, you know, the body wants to have a normal blood pressure and a normal heart rate. So it's going to, the kidney and brain work together to sort of make that happen. All right. So in order to understand blood pressure, we have to take our cardiac output idea, and we have to add something to it, and that's total peripheral resistance, or TPR. And we have to talk a little bit about just some basic physics of fluids moving in tubes to sort of understand this. Anytime you push a fluid through a pipe or through a tube, the pipe pushes back, and that's what we call resistance. There's just like moving an object through the air pushes back on it. Same is true in a plumbing system or in a cardiovascular system. As the blood flows through the cardiovascular system, it encounters resistance. And there are four principal sources of resistance to flow. And three of those are not important to how we think about blood pressure, and one is hugely important. All right, so all that resistance together in all of the vessels is what we call total peripheral resistance. Total because it's all of the vessels in the body. That's what we're thinking about. Peripheral because most of the pressure comes not from the arteries and veins close to the heart. It comes from the peripheral veins. So the arteries and veins that are out there at the edges of the system. And then we call it resistance because that's what it is. It's the pressure, or not the pressure, but it's the resistance to flow that all of those tubes are making. All right, so where does it come from? Four characteristics. The first is vessel length. Physics tells us the longer the tube, the higher the resistance. So if you've ever, you know, playing around at a fast food restaurant, put multiple straws together and then tried to drink through them, the longer the straw, the harder it is to do that. That is vessel length. So the longer the tube, the higher the resistance. Now, in the human, at least once they've reached adulthood, vessel length doesn't change. You know, our vessels are the same length all the time. So because it doesn't change, we can sort of ignore it as a component of total peripheral resistance. It's contributing still, but it doesn't change, so we can sort of, you know, it's a constant, so we can ignore it. So that's one. Viscosity. Harder to drink a milkshake through a straw than water through a straw, right? That is this property. The thicker the fluid, the greater the resistance. So here again, an important characteristic of resistance, but in our bodies, the viscosity of the blood doesn't change. So we can sort of, again, ignore it. Now, there are sort of oddball cases where viscosity can start to play a role. In a person who's very dehydrated, for example, the viscosity of their blood is going to be much higher because there's not enough water in it. So you may start to get into blood pressure problems from viscosity, but typically you don't. The viscosity of the blood stays the same. All right. The third resistance maker is turbulence. So fluids like to flow nice and smoothly. That's no sharp corners, no sharp bends. Walls are nice and smooth. So anytime you don't have that, when you start to try to move fluid through a strange shaped or a twisting pipe, you get turbulence. The water bumps into itself. You know, just like in a river, you know, in a rapids area, you know, the water actually flows slower for the, well, we won't get into all that complexity, but all that turbulence, water can bump against itself, that causes resistance. Here again, in the body, that doesn't change. The vascular system, the anatomy, is pretty much fixed after childhood. So because the turbulence doesn't change, we can ignore it, even though it's a component of that. All right. But the last one is vessel diameter. Okay, so this is the one that does change. This is the one, this is how the whole system manages itself. And that, and the physics rule here is the smaller the pipe, the greater the resistance. Again, you can use an example. If you drink through a regular straw and then you try to drink through one of those coffee stirrer straws, it's much more difficult to pull it up through the coffee stirrer. That's because it's much, much smaller in diameter. So the bigger around the pipe, the lower the resistance. And this this factor isn't linear. In other words, it's exponential. So when you double the size of the pipe, you you drop the resistance by like a quarter or by an eighth. So it's actually to the fourth power. So it's a very pronounced effect. So what does all that mean? It means that a small change in vessel size creates a large change in resistance. When a vessel gets bigger, the resistance gets much lower. When a vessel gets smaller, the resistance gets much higher. So the reason that arteries have smooth muscle in their walls is so they can do vasoconstriction and vasodilation. Essentially, they can change their diameter, and by changing their diameter, they change their resistance. By changing the resistance, they change the flow of blood through that vessel. So this is the important piece, is vessel diameter change. All right. All right. So to sort of start to put all these pieces together, we have to look at a few characteristics of the cardiovascular system. So what we're looking at here on the y-axis is vessel diameter, how big the vessel is, and on the x-axis, we're traveling through the cardiovascular system, right? So from the heart to the aorta, big arteries, medium arteries, tiny arterioles, capillaries, venules, veins, and vena cava back up. So what is this graph showing us? It's showing us that the vessels start out large, they get smaller and smaller and smaller until we get to the capillaries, and then the vessels start getting bigger and bigger and bigger again, right? So this, you already knew this. You know, as you go out into the cardiovascular system, the vessels get smaller. Now there gets to be more of them, and that plays a role in how blood flows through the whole system. But generally speaking, you know, the largest vessels are the ones that are by the heart. So a way to sort of remember this is it's just like the road system in a city. The interstates are large roads, right? But there aren't very many of them. Whereas the side streets are small roads, but there are a ton of them. So it's this same idea. So, you know, the aorta and the vena cava, they're interstates, right? But the capillaries are, you know, alleyways and side streets. So the roads get smaller as there gets to be more and more of them. All right, so that's the first property. The second one has to do with pressure. Put a little asterisk by this chart right here because this is one that students very frequently get wrong. So it's worth, you know, sort of taking an extra look at it, even maybe just before the test. Because I'm always surprised that there are a significant number of students that miss this piece. All right, it goes like this. As you go from aorta back to the heart at vena cava, what happens to the pressure in the vessels? Well, it starts high because, you know, in the aorta, the heart has sort of put a bunch of pressure there, right? And then as we go down through the rest of the vascular system, the pressure is always getting smaller, all right? Here's the piece students miss. The pressure in the capillaries is greater than the pressure in the veins is. And it has to be like that because flow happens when we go from an area of high pressure to an area of low pressure, right? So in order to keep blood flowing back to the heart, it means that each successive part of the vascular system has to have a lower pressure. because blood is always going to flow towards the low pressure zone. And I think that students get this one a little mixed up, because we all know that capillaries are very, very small and fragile, right? And that there's a ton of them. So we think, well, the pressure must be lowest there. No, the pressure is lowest in the veins going back to the heart, in the vena cava. So one way to remember this is my roller coaster analogy. All right, so you get on the roller coaster, and what's the first thing that happens? They haul you up a great big hill, right? That's the heart. That's what the heart does. It empowers, or it charges up the blood with blood pressure. And then you go down that first hill, and the whole rest of the thing is powered by gravity, right? You don't have to get hauled up again. That's exactly the same way that the cardiovascular system works. So the heart pressurizes the system, and then the whole rest of the way, it's all downhill from there. So we go from big arteries to medium arteries to arterioles to capillaries, venules, veins, vena cava. And then we're back to the heart again. We're going to get hauled back up to the high pressure point, right? So blood is always moving from areas of high pressure to low pressure. So if you encountered a question that said, where in the vascular system is pressure the lowest, the answer is going to be vena cava, right? Not capillaries, right? So that's blood pressure. And this is, of all these graphs, this one is really kind of the most important, because this is what keeps blood flowing through the system. You know, how does blood that has arrived at your feet, how does it get back to the heart? Because the pressure is less above it than it is below it. So blood can actually move against gravity, powered by this pressure difference. All right. Okay, so another is velocity. So as we go through the system, the speed of the blood changes. So in the large vessels, in the aorta and in the vena cava, blood is moving very fast. But as the vessels get smaller, the speed gets slower. So the interstate example, or the road system example, works here too. Interstates are high-speed, big roads, right? You could never drive that fast on the side streets. Right? So same system. We have high speed big roads, and we have low speed small roads as we go through. Now, there's a reason that this happens, and that's because as the vessels get smaller and smaller, there gets to be more and more of them. So another way of looking at this is like a river. You know, if it's passing through a canyon, it moves very fast. But when it goes out onto a broad plain, it slows way down. So it's this same pattern that we see there, that velocity is highest in the bigger vessels and lowest in the smaller ones because there's so many more of them. All right. Okay. So you've heard me say a number of times that it's the capillary bed is where all the work gets done, right? Well, this is some of the work that gets done there. So most of what the cardiovascular system does is keep things moving through the capillary beds, so that at the capillary beds, good stuff can drift out into the tissues and waste products can drift in. And that's all by diffusion. But in addition to diffusion, diffusion is molecules moving. Also at the capillary bed, we get some fluid moving as well. And there's two major players here. All right, so inside the vascular system, there's a pressure. Right, we just saw that in this graph right here. So in the capillary, there is a blood pressure, and it's greater than that in the veins. So that pressure inside the capillaries is pushing out. You know, it's going to have a tendency to push fluid out of the vascular system and into the surrounding tissues. So what would be in these spaces here and here would be the cells that make up this tissue. Let's say it's a muscle tissue. So there would be muscle cells out here and down here. All right, so that's the capillary hydrostatic pressure, is the pressure pushing out of the vascular system. Now, opposing that pressure is the harder to understand one, and that's blood colloid osmotic pressure. All right, the easiest way to describe this is blood has a ton of stuff dissolved in it, right? You know, when we first started the semester, we talked about the plasma and all the stuff that was in it, plasma proteins and stuff. Well, there's so much stuff dissolved in the plasma that blood pulls water towards it all the time. So The blood colloid osmotic pressure is the blood's pull on surrounding fluid as it tries to pull water in to itself. So we have these opposing forces. Capillary hydrostatic pressure pushing out, blood colloid osmotic pressure pulling in. All right, so what does that cause? Well, across the capillary bed, there's sort of three regions. In this first region, the capillary hydrostatic pressure is greater than the colloid osmotic pressure. So what does that mean? It means that fluid is going to get pushed out into the tissue. And that happens at about 24 liters per day for all of your capillaries all over your body, right? Well, and then in the center part of the capillary, they're in balance, so nothing moves. And then distal part of the capillary, it's opposite. The colloid osmotic pressure is actually greater than the hydrostatic pressure, so fluid is pulled back in. So if we do a little math, 24 out, 20.4 in, well, what's the difference? 3.6, right? So where does that fluid go? It goes into the lymphatic system. And that is what we're going to start talking about after our exam. The first chapter in Unit 2 is the lymphatic system. So we're going to find that 3.6 liters in a week or so. And we're going to see what happens to it later. But this is movement of fluid at the capillary. So we have these opposing forces. Water goes out, or fluid goes out, fluid comes back. But there's a little difference that's then recovered through a separate system. All right, so the whole thing has to be regulated so that the tissues of the body get what they need and that the body doesn't waste energy on creating too much blood pressure or too much blood flow. And there are three layers of control. The first is autoregulation. So that's this box right here. Essentially what autoregulation is tissues can control their own blood flow by causing vasoconstriction or vasodilation at their own capillary beds. So it's sort of like having a thermostat in your room that you can control. You know, you don't have to go out in the hallway, you don't have to call, somebody else. You can adjust the temperature of the room because that thermostat affects your room. Well, the tissues of the body can do that same thing. They can adjust the thermostat, so to speak, to increase blood flow or decrease blood flow. So in a busy tissue that needs more oxygen and more nutrients, the blood flow will increase as the signs of activity increase. So for example, in a busy tissue, CO2 levels are going to rise, right? Because the cells are busy making ATP. Well, as the CO2 levels rise, that's a trigger for vasodilation. So as that tissue gets busier, the blood flow increases. The opposite is also true. You know, as oxygen levels increase, vasoconstriction happens. So in a tissue that isn't busy, vasoconstriction will happen to reduce blood flow. So autoregulation, the tissues control their own flow according to what they need. And this is how most cardiovascular regulation happens, is inside this autoregulation. It works great as long as there's enough blood pressure in the body. So autoregulation fails when there is an inadequate blood pressure in the system, right? Because, a muscle region, for example, it can't do anything about systemic blood pressure because it's just a tiny little region and it has other things to do. So when autoregulation fails, then we get into the system-wide regulations that come through hormonal mechanisms and neural mechanisms. All right, so we have autoregulation and central regulation. So when this fails, this kicks in. And essentially, we've got two paths. The neural mechanism, that's the autonomic nervous system again. If blood pressure is too low to satisfy the needs of the tissues, the sympathetic nervous system is going to turn things up. So the heart rate's going to go up, contractility is going to go up, that's going to make cardiac output go up. The neural system also causes peripheral vasoconstriction. So as all of the vessels of the body sort of get smaller, the total resistance goes up, so that increases blood pressure.
So sympathetic is here, here, and here. So that's the neural mechanism. The other mechanism comes through the kidney, of all places, and it's a hormone system, which we'll talk more about in a minute. So the neural and hormonal mechanisms. All right. So what does this look like? All right, so here's one of those homeostasis diagrams, right? So here's normal heart rate, normal blood pressure. So what happens if your blood pressure gets too high? Well, we have blood pressure sensors in the body. They're called baroreceptors. We find them in a number of important spots, and they tell the brain about the current blood pressure. So when the blood pressure gets too high, those sensors detect that, and they respond by, first of all, decreasing cardiac output and increasing vasodilation. So essentially, when the blood pressure gets too high, cardiac output is turned down, and total peripheral resistance is turned down through vasodilation. Both of those things reduce blood pressure, which was the original problem. So it brings things back to normal. Now, how does it do that? There's three mechanisms. One is affect heart rate. So if the blood pressure is too high, the heart rate will go down. Another is to affect contractility. So if the blood pressure is too high, make the heart beat less well, and that will lower cardiac output. And then the last piece is at the arterioles, which is where most total peripheral resistance comes from. All right. So that's the too high. What about the too low? Well, the blood pressure sensors detect that, and we get the opposite effects. So we get vasoconstriction that increases total peripheral resistance. We get cardiac acceleration. In other words, the heart rate goes up. And we get, we inhibit the cardioinhibitory effect, but don't worry about that. But we increase vasoconstriction, increase cardiac output. That increases blood pressure. So why? Because there has to be enough blood pressure for autoregulation to occur. If there's not, then there isn't any energy to make blood flow through those vessels. So the body sort of defends a blood pressure all the time. All right. And I think you're going to do some blood pressure stuff in lab this week. I hope, anyway, because it's a great lab for sort of putting some of these things right in front of you, so to speak. Okay, so.
I think we're like a week off then, because we just did a bunch of blood pressure.
Yeah, we did that last Thursday.
Good. So some of this stuff.
Thing, like, it seems like our lecture should be before what we do in lab, and it's how it works.
Okay.
I don't really mind what you talk about it.
Yeah. See, it depends. Can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
But at least it's all the same information, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so what about this kidney system? You know, the neural system is sort of easy to understand, because it's, it affects sympathetic nervous system, parasympathetic nervous system. This piece is a little more complicated. All right, so the kidney not only responds to a decrease in blood pressure, but it responds to two other things as well. That's this part.
Ooh, what we're going to talk about right now.
So when blood pressure is too low, when oxygen levels are too low, or when plasma volume, in other words, circulating blood volume, when it is too low, the kidney has the same response to all three of those scenarios. And the reason, it does sort of make sense. Why would the kidney respond the same way to these three different things? Because they're all interrelated. If your blood pressure is too low for too long, your oxygen level will drop because your tissues aren't getting enough oxygen. If your plasma volume, if the amount of blood in the system is too low, you're going to have trouble maintaining the blood pressure anyway, and the tissues are going to starve for oxygen because there isn't enough blood in the first place. So this is a simplification of like the next three or four slides. So blood pressure, oxygen, plasma volume all have the same effects as the kidney. And that is the kidney produces renin. Okay, so renin is an enzyme. It comes from a particular part of the kidney that's very sensitive to blood flow and oxygen. So when any of these three conditions are present,
renin is made. Well, what does renin do? Renin triggers the formation of angiotensin 1. So this is commonly referred to as AT1, but it's angiotensin. So angiotensin 1. Now it turns out, so renin makes angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 doesn't do much. So it's sort of inert. It's sort of it has to be activated. So angiotensin 1 is transformed into angiotensin 2, AT2, by an enzyme which you may have heard of, and that is the ACE enzyme. Angiotensin converting enzyme. That's what the ACE means. A very, very common blood pressure medicine that people are on today is called an ACE inhibitor, and it targets this enzyme specifically. So it's found in the lungs, the ACE enzyme is, and its only job is it turns angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. Now, why is that important? Because angiotensin 2 does all kinds of things that have to do with blood pressure. So even though renin makes angiotensin 1, angiotensin 1 doesn't do anything. In order to become active, it has to become angiotensin 2, thus the importance of that ACE enzyme. All right, so what does AT2 do? Well, it's going to target three things. It wants to increase blood pressure. It wants to increase vasoconstriction, because that also increases blood pressure. And then it also wants to increase plasma volume. So it does multiple things. So one is angiotensin 2 causes vasoconstriction, right, directly at the arterioles. We can see that here, widespread vasoconstriction. So that increases blood pressure. Angiotensin 2 also increases heart rate, which does the same thing. And then the other major player in this system, angiotensin 2 triggers the release of aldosterone from the adrenal glands. Aldosterone, as we'll spend more time on aldosterone in the kidney chapter and in the fluid chapter, but for now, aldosterone is the salt hormone. So it triggers the body to hold on to salt. And a rule of thumb in physiology is water always follows salt. So if you move salt in the body, water comes along behind it. So aldosterone causes the kidney to hold on to salt. As it does that, water follows along behind it, and that helps to increase plasma volume. Another thing angiotensin 2 does is it makes you thirsty. So the more you drink, the higher your plasma volume, the greater your venous return, stroke volume, cardiac output, and blood pressure, right? So this is the introduction to a system called the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. And we're going to see it a couple of other times as we go. But for this chapter, it's an endocrine response to a decrease in blood pressure, oxygen, or plasma volume, right? And so renin makes angiotensin, angiotensin 2 makes aldosterone, and aldosterone increases plasma volume. Now, the other role of the kidney when blood pressure, oxygen, plasma volume are too low, is the kidney also makes EPO, erythropoiesis. So in addition, here we're going to just add this. So in response to those things, the kidney also makes erythropoietin. What does it do? It triggers the production of red blood cells. So this whole renin system really only works on fluid. But ultimately, you need to have more red blood cells too if you have a blood pressure problem. So the kidney releases erythropoietin, and erythropoietin triggers the production of red blood cells from the bone marrow, which increases blood volume and blood pressure, and then eventually we get all the way back up to our normal blood pressure and blood volume. All right, so these kidney effects, they take place over hours or days, right? So they're kind of a long-term solution. So in the short term, we see the body do what we've already talked about, which is through the neural system. The autonomic nervous system, the sympathetic nervous system,
it can change things very quickly. So in the short term, what will increase your blood pressure is those sympathetic nervous system effects, increased heart rate, increased contractility, vasoconstriction. But in the long term, the kidney is going to affect the blood volume and the overall blood makeup to fix it in a long-term way. So we have short-term effects and long-term effects. All right. What about the other case? What happens when the blood volume is too high?
Well, first of all, that doesn't happen very often. You know, you have to remember that, you know, we evolved out there in nature, and water is sometimes hard to find. So as long as you're mentally fit, you shouldn't drink more than you need, right? Because why would you be drinking if you're not thirsty? So this scenario doesn't happen in nature very often where you have too much circulating blood volume. However, in modern American medicine, it happens more frequently than it should because we love to give patients fluids when they get to the hospital, right? And sometimes we give them too much. So there is a system for this, and it's triggered or managed by the heart itself. So you've given a patient three boluses of fluid in the ER, and that was one too many, right? So what happens? Well, because there's too much plasma volume, there's extra venous return, so there's extra end-diastolic volume. In other words, the heart is getting like stretched out as it fills up because there's extra blood around. The response of the heart to that stretch is to release these hormones called natriuretic peptides. And they're not called natriuretic because they're natural, they're called natriuretic from natrium, the periodic table. Sodium is Na, that's natrium. So these are sodium-related peptides, natriuretic. And what they do is they cause the body to dump fluid, basically. So at the kidney, the aldosterone effect is blocked, so sodium is lost in the urine. Water follows along behind it, so the water goes into the urine. So we get an increased water loss in the urine. Thirst is reduced or turned off by these natriuretic peptides. And then a number of hormones are inhibited to allow that water to disappear, or that water to be voided out while the heart is sort of relaxing and slowing down. So we get a number of effects to a too high blood pressure situation, but like I said, that doesn't occur very often. So eventually, these natriuretic peptides cause a reduction in blood volume and a reduction in blood pressure, which fixes the original problem, right? Okay, so the rest of these homeostasis diagrams from your book, essentially, they repeat the same things, and that is because of this relationship right here. So, like, this one is about decreasing oxygen levels. The body responds to a decrease in oxygen the same way it does to a decrease in blood pressure. And that sort of makes sense. If you have a decrease in oxygen, you don't have enough circulating blood volume, or you don't have enough blood pressure to make blood flow. The other piece that goes along with this is the lungs become involved. When the oxygen level is too low, the lungs are stimulated to breathe more and faster and deeper, so that additional oxygen gets brought in. All right. Because we're about out of time, I'm just sort of skipping through some of these. When we go to exercise, the system can change pretty dramatically. If you look at this number right here, that cardiac output number, you can see that we go from about 6 liters per minute at rest up to almost 17.5 liters per minute with heavy exercise. And if you look at this diagram, you know, what's the piece that's changing? Well, the skin is flow is going up, but then, of course, the massive flow is to the skeletal muscles. So this cardiovascular system of ours is incredibly adaptive because when you're at rest like you are now, it's very efficient. You know, it doesn't use much energy, but it can turn itself up to allow you to do, you know, heavy exercise over a long time. You know, the human can run a marathon. There aren't very many animals that can do that, that can run for that long
at that speed. And the reason for that is our amazing cardiovascular system, at least in part. All right. All right, so that's it for today. Even though I skipped over some of these homeostasis slides, you need to spend time on them because we didn't talk about it, but it's good to go through them as the book presents them because there'll be questions on that stuff. All right?